You guys wouldn't mind humor me for a few minutes with some yarn, would you? Donna, would you help us out? And you can sit right there, but hold on to that end. Now take the ball of yarn and just pass it around. And Amber, when you get it, hold on to a piece. Yeah, and just pass it around. All right, ready? And keep that going. All right. Mr. Brady, will you do the same thing here? We need to web everyone up. Let me start with Noelle over here. Noelle, would you hold this end? And if you want, you can throw it to Faith. Hold on to it, and then pass it to somebody else. Don't knock over anybody's coffee. Then you will make enemies. We don't want to do that. Good, and do it in silence, please. You're doing perfect. Good. Right. Are so far so good. Where's it? Okay, good. We need to mix this up just a little bit more. Okay, go from one table to another, maybe. Just toss it over here. Heads up. Here it comes. Don't let go of it. Hold on to it. Wonderful. If we make sure we gotta get everybody. We gotta web everybody up. Good. Don't let go. Keep holding on. Thank you. Thank you for being good sports today. There's three balls of yarn going around, and they're intertwining now. Okay, what color is that yarn, everybody? Church is a place. This is tough for some folks. So I'm going to tell you some tough stuff about church today. Are you guys up for that? Are you game? Okay. The things we're going to learn today about the church are very different from what you often hear. And I'm going to start it off this way. I'll start off slowly. Church is a place of relationships. Would you guys say relationships? We are tied together by our relationship with Jesus Christ. If you are sitting here this morning and you have a real saving relationship with Jesus Christ, would you say, I do? And that is the rope that binds you all together. And as I look out here, I see people who are very different from one another, who've come from all different places, and look how they're tied together. And we're all tied together because we have this red cord in common, the blood of Jesus Christ. Right, everyone? Let's go back over there. Give me some slack. Hey, cut me some slack. There's something in that too. Cut me some slack here. Okay, perfect. 1 Corinthians 13, cut me some slack. Good. Okay, we can be done now, right? Did we get everybody? I don't want anybody left out. Did we get everybody? No. What happened? Who did we miss? Oh, Meg, somehow get them in on it. You guys got to fix that over there. Tie them together. And it comes from all the way over here, Donnie. Oh, good. Yeah, we've got all the youth back there. All right, Donnie, let's see what you can do. Yes! Donnie just threw it across the room. Perfect. All right. Look, we got everybody tied together. Okay, perfect. We are, as you hold on to this little string, you know that this string that ties us together, this rope that binds us and moves us together as one and causes us to be dependent upon one another, you know that this rope is a lot stronger than a piece of yarn. In fact, many of you have found out the hard way that this tie is even more powerful than the tie that you have with some of your own relatives, some of your own blood kin. And it is a tie of faith, it is a tie of trust in your relationship with Jesus. And here we are today with this piece of string that binds us all together in our church, and little churches meeting all over the world today. And we are thankful for it. Would you say relationships?
Relationships.
My mother's father, I called him Grandpa Keeling. Jack Keeling was a World War II vet, and he lived in Farmville, Virginia. How many of you know where Farmville, Virginia is? Yeah, good. And in his retirement, he had a nice big garden, and there was a heavy rain, and he went out to the garden in the morning, and he was a big man, and he got to the garden and got one foot stuck in the mud, and immediately got the second foot stuck in the mud. So the more he worked at it, the deeper he got. And he loved to tell jokes and funny stories. So according to him, at this point, the mud was up to his hip. right? And he called out for my grandmother, who was back way back over at the house. He had to call out for her and call out for her. And finally, here she came with a rope in hand. And he told her, "I'm so stuck. Thank you for coming." And she said, "No problem, Jack. Tie this around your neck and I'll pull you out of there." And that's the way he told it. She was the sweetest, quietest, most godly woman you've ever met. And then she was married to him. Anybody know that situation? Anybody live in that? Here's the truth of it all. Whether we admit it or not, we are all stuck in the mud to some degree or another right now. And some of us are more stuck than others. All of us are a little bit stuck. And you know what we need? We need to be bound together by a group of people, not just one person, not just two, but how about 100 people who are all tied together to pull us along. Would you say pull us along? Can you feel that right there? Give Ray a little pull. And when I give Ray a little pull, he gives Cal and Dave a little pull, right? And what do we pull one another on towards, everyone? What do we pull one another on towards? Following Jesus, right? And here at the camp, we remind ourselves every January of how exactly we do this. I'm going to pull you, and you're going to pull me, and I'm a little stuck in the mud, and you're a little stuck in the mud, and I'm going to pull you towards biblical worship. And I would say, hey, come on, worship. It's worship. All right, give somebody a little pull. Give somebody a little pull. This is what we do. This is why church exists. And not only that, each week, each time I meet with you, I'm going to pull you on towards biblical family. I'm going to say, hey, biblical family, come on, we're all going. I can't really go till you go. We're all going towards biblical family. You're getting the hang of this. You're doing a great job. One more, right? Next step, relationships. I say, I see you hiding out, and I know you're depressed, and I know you're scared. But look, we must obey Jesus and get that life-giving nourishment that relationships have. So come on, I'm pulling you towards relationships. Everybody say, come on. We're all going, right? And we go there together. So we're pulling one another on towards relationships, biblical relationships, spiritual relationships where we tell the truth in love. And then finally, here's one that's way out of our comfort zone. My feet are standing still this time. You're going to have to drag me. You're going to have to drag me. And everybody say, okay. All right. Everyone say, biblical missions. Biblical missions. Say, here we go. We're going. Pastor Donnie's pulling us towards the way of the master and evangelism. Come on, we're all going. And a lot of us are dragging our feet, but when this many people are all tied together, we're going to get there. All right? We're going to get there. So let me just take just a moment to say this. Every January, February, we pause, we review why we exist as a church, and we remind ourselves of what this compass means. Here is how we make disciples at the camp. All together, we practice worship. All together, look, we work on our families. All together, we're working on relationships. All together, we're working on missions. And we start that over again week after week, month after month, year after year. And we die doing that. And we grow in Christ together because disciples are made in the congregation. And that's why we exist. And so this particular winter, we've been learning that Father God wants us to be distinguished, right, everyone? To stand out, to be distinct, set apart, or as he would say, holy, different from everyone else. And so today, especially, we're going to learn that Father God wants us to be distinguished by our relationships. Would you say that with me? Father God wants us to be distinguished by our relationships. Our relationships with our church family should be different. They should be odd when we step out of the world and say, no, you don't understand. I need my church family. And I'll tell you very specifically why I need them for X, Y, and Z in my spiritual growth. And this is our testimony to the world. God wants us to stand out in that because Psalm 133, Hinei matov umanaim shaveth akim gam yachad. How good and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together as one. It's a sweet, wonderful thing. So many blessings, so many graces come to us through God's family. Father God wants us to be distinguished by our relationships. So we're going to do a little chart work again today. Have you guys enjoyed our charts? Say, I've loved them. Love the charts. Can I let go of the rope now? No, you hold on to the yarn. You're going to need that a little bit longer. Here is our chart for the day. I want to compare a couple things. I want to compare movie theater church with biblical church. We're learning to distinguish the true Jesus of the Bible and the modern Jesus who is made up. We're learning to distinguish biblical Christianity from what the world and Oprah Winfrey calls Christianity. Okay? Everybody is a Christian, right? We're learning to distinguish what those things are, and today we're going to do it with church. There is, on the one hand, movie theater church, and there is, on the other hand, biblical church. Now, in movie theater church, it's all about tickets. Tickets, tickets, tickets. This ticket, my church membership, entitles me to my seat, to my entertainment. Come, I have arrived. Bless me if you can. Teach me if you can. And entitles me to my privacy and leave me alone. Because when this movie's over, I'll be out of here. And I'm going to go do my own thing because I'm an American. I do my own thing. No accountability, just leave me alone. Tickets, tickets, tickets. On the other hand, biblical church is all about ties. Ties, ties, ties. Some of us are going, I knew it. It is important to wear those. Not neckties, Donnie. You're okay. Not neckties, Jerry. You're all right for now. Okay? Not neckties. But these ties, the ties that we don't have a choice. We are bound together by our relationship. And I look to the left of me, and I look to the right of me, and I think, that's my brother, and that's my sister. Oh. Right? But the truth is, we are family, tied together by the blood of Jesus, and we actually depend upon one another, right? So we will say we need one another. These are the ties. Now, back over in the movie theater church, church is all about my ticket, my seat, my privacy, my entertainment. Do not sit in my seat. That's my seat. I've already put my Bible in it, and my coffee is right beside it. That's my seat. Oh, wait a minute. This seat's not that good. I think I'll take that seat. That seat's better. This is my seat. Once I sit in it, everyone leave me alone because now it's me in the movie, right? It's all about that seat. Is it comfortable enough? Sorry, how's the temperature in the room today? You guys too hot, too cold? How's the preaching? Is it just right for you? Was the singing snappy enough for everyone? Did it make you feel good? Right? It's all about that comfort level, isn't it? And if you make it uncomfortable, guess what's going to happen? You're going to hear that movie theater seat go, pum, 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 pum. And I'll just go find another place that has better seats. Fancier seats. Ooh, seats with footrests that come out. Right? You get a first class seat. But then in biblical church, now you're going to have to humor me even more. In biblical church, it's all about locking together to form. Come on, you want to yell it out. To form the defender of the universe, Voltron. Now, give me just a second, okay, because this is long before Power Rangers and the Megazord. Yep. Long before the Destructicons, right, there was Voltron. Now, let me tell you really quickly about the cartoon. In this cartoon and the toys and everything, there was in outer space this group of people who piloted these little lion machines that could fly and do awesome things. But then when they had to battle a really big guy, a really bad enemy, you know what they would do? They would all form up together and lock in together to form Voltron, the defender of the universe. Now, I'm not being disrespectful, but had the Apostle Paul known about Voltron, you would have heard about an illustration in 1 Corinthians 12 using Voltron. This is the deal. As individual Christians, we are not all that impressive. And people knock us and say how we're hypocrites. But when you lock us together in spirit-filled, loving relationships in the congregation, we become literally unstoppable. And that is the mystery of God himself. And he wants it to be that way. In the movie theater church, we are very light on relationships, and that's why we like it. But in biblical church, we are very heavy on relationships, and that makes it uncomfortable and sometimes dangerous. Right? 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Let's keep holding on to the string for just a tiny bit longer. 1 Corinthians 12 is our passage today. And just for reading, we're going to read verses 12 to 14. And we're going to start things off with the Apostle Paul's body imagery that he uses here that speaks to us so much. And we keep in mind Voltron, and we see these building blocks coming together. This is how dependent we are upon one another as a church. 1 Corinthians 12. Now I'm going to ask, Chris is going to come up here, and he's going to read this out loud for us in the microphone. But would the rest of you just take your Bibles, and are you able to stand up with your string too? Not lose it? And don't fall down? I knew you could do it. Perfect. Now, can Chris make it through this? Chris, do it. Chris can do it. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and then please find verse 12. And then follow along as Chris reads this out loud in his Bible.
For as the body is one and has many parts, and all the parts of that body, though many, are one body, so also is Christ. For we are all baptized by one Spirit into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free. And we were all made to drink of one Spirit. So the body is not one part, but many.
And the entire camp said, Amen. Amen. And Chris, would you pray for us now?
Sure. Dear God, I thank you for this church. I thank you that you have allowed us to stand even through the troublesome year that we've had, Lord. I thank you for the people and the body, Lord. And I thank you that you continue to strengthen us and lift us up. I pray now as Pastor Trey brings your word, Lord, that you would be with him and that you would give him the words to say. And I just pray for us that we would be calm and peaceful, Lord, and be able to understand your word, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Please be seated. Let's see. Can you guys pull this in now? At some point, you're going to need to get up and leave, and I think we're going to trip everybody. Yeah, thank you. Let's just, you can break it. Just get rid of it if you can. Help me out with that. Thank you for humoring me through Voltron and through the red yarn. I really appreciate that. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We're going to spend some time today in verses 15 down through verse 26, okay? Yeah, 15 through 26. So as you get rid of your yarn, thank you. And if you want to keep that yarn and make special sweaters for everyone that say relationships on them, that would be great. I figured this would take a minute, Jerry. But the whole sermon takes like 3 minutes, but the yarn I knew would... That would take 30 minutes, so there you go. Thank you. Good job, guys. I appreciate your help. Perfect, Gabe. Gabe is a machine over here, everybody. Look at him. There's no place where Excellent. We can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. Seriously, I think Pastor Ruben would like to have this yarn for some of the stuff he's been making. He's getting really good at the knit one, purl two. Maybe at least a scarf, a relationship scarf. Thanks, everybody. Okay, here. Hey, yes, yes, good job. All right, here is the. Thank you, Donnie. Perfect. I started off as three balls of yarn. Oh, okay. Okay, good. All right, let's open up our Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and we're going to begin in verse 15. And I want to summarize these verses and the points that we find in them. I want to summarize it this way. And don't let this slip by. This is kind of important. This is kind of heavy, but here's my summary. God built church members to need other church members for spiritual growth. Hang out with me on this for just a second before we move forward. God built church members to need other church members for spiritual growth. And what you're going to see today is we're going to hang out in 1 Corinthians 12 and then watch. I'm just going to flash back to Ephesians 4 in just a moment. I'm going to do that a couple times because in Ephesians 4 we see that spiritual growth depends upon relationships in the congregation. Now, here's the main gist of this that's different. Every Christian devotional book, all the songs that you hear, and so many sermons that you hear tell us that all you need is Jesus. You don't need anything else. So you don't really need the church, and you don't really need these brothers and sisters around you, which sounds kind of pious, but is just not biblical. Because what we're learning today is what God has taught us about the way He has designed it. So when I say words like need here, I mean need. I mean like I cannot do this without them. So if you can bring yourself to do it, would you say this out loud with me? God built church members to need other church members for spiritual growth. One more time. God built church members to need other church members for spiritual growth. None of us has all of the spiritual gifts. None of us is completely sufficient. We think that if I just walk with Jesus on the mountain and have great prayer times on the trail, then I'm good and I'm growing in Jesus. But as I've said many times, I'm convicted of everybody, that's a spiritual fantasy life. Because I can be the most loving, graceful person in the world when I'm not surrounded by people. When I'm listening, you know, I'm reading my devotional, I'm reading the Bible, and I'm listening to some Jeremy Camp song, and I am the most godly person I could ever imagine being. Right? And then stick me in the middle of 100 people who know it's their duty to keep me accountable and to encourage me. And now all of a sudden I realize I've got some areas I need to work on. And let me throw this out here at the beginning, something I truly believe. There are areas in my life that I will never get better at. And that is okay. And I'll pray, for example, I'll pray for the Lord. Lord, I need help in this area. And I always assumed everybody growing up that what that meant was just, that's just another thing God's going to do in my life. He'll grow me and make me a perfect mercy shower. And then He'll grow me in some other way, make me a perfect encourager. Then He'll make me a perfect prayer warrior in all these ways until finally I'm just perfect. Did you guys have that fantasy also? But instead, this is just what I found out myself. I don't know about you. But I pray for the Lord. Lord, I need to be a better mercy shower. And I see that so often. And He says, and He brings along somebody to me who is a heavy mercy shower. And that person makes up for what is lacking inside of me and probably always will. Have you guys discovered that already? Have you seen that? It's a little discouraging in some ways, but then again, it's exciting in others. So watch, I'm going to actually say this in a couple different ways because I think this is a tricky one. So let me say it a couple different ways, and I have these for the screen here. I'm going to say it this way, ready? I experience spiritual growth only insofar as I am connected to the spirit-filled relationships of the congregation. In other words, I don't read in the Bible a mechanism for my spiritual growth that happens alone. Yes, I pray alone, but when I find texts in Scripture about spiritual growth, they're always about relationships. Here's the second way. I cannot experience spiritual growth on my own. I need a church family or I will not grow, period. We always have that debate. Well, do you have to go to church to be a Christian? Well, a good Christian will go to church. Listen, if you don't care about going to church, you never go to church, you're not a Christian. You haven't gone to church for years and years and you don't care anything about it. There's just not a way to acknowledge what Scripture says about the congregation and the people of God and say, I don't care about them. So I need more, and this is the one that's going to be hard for some of us. I need more than Jesus to grow in my relationship with Jesus, and Jesus designed it to be so. In case you think I'm trying to say something heretical to you that would pull you away from Jesus, look, this is his design. You need more than just your prayer times with me. You need the mechanism I've put in place, and that is my bride, my church. So let me say that one more time, because that's a hard one. I need more than Jesus to grow in my relationship with Jesus, and Jesus designed it to be so. Jesus said, I'm giving you my church, and church is where disciples are made. So God built church members to need other church members to spiritual growth, and you feel it in you. You have this need. He built you with that need in there. And so here's the first thing we're going to see in verses 15 to 19. Other church members need you for their spiritual growth. Other church members need you for their spiritual growth. Let's begin reading verse 15. If the foot should say, well, I'm not a hand, so I'm not really part of the body. I mean, hands are important. Everybody likes hands. But feet, ugh. There are tons of people who hate feet. Right? Well, I'm not really important. And then verse 16, and if the ears should say, man, if I was an eye, if I was, you know, if only I was an eye, and then I would matter, and then I'd be part of the body, you know, then I'd make sense. Verse 17, but if the whole body were an eye, then where would be the hearing? And if the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? That means noses are important too, right, everyone? Verse 18, but now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as he pleased. Can you hear him snapping the pieces together? Can you hear that, everyone? Setting them, snapping them together, and he's doing it just as he pleased. And verse 19, and if they were all one member, where would the body be? In other words, a body by definition must have a variety of different parts. If it's all one part, then it's no longer a body. That makes sense, right? And it's as if Paul is specifically speaking to that person who's sitting in the congregation, looking around, thinking of their own sin and thinking of their own weaknesses and going, these people don't need me. They don't need me for their spiritual growth. They're fine. And I'm thankful for that because I don't really have it in me to make any investment in these people anyway. I'm just here to see if there's any hope at all and maybe a pick-me-up and I'll go back out again. And this passage is specifically for those people saying, listen, other church members need you for their spiritual growth. They absolutely need you. In fact, they are dependent upon you showing up and using your spiritual gift on them. Everybody see that? This particular section is for that group of people. Now, flip with me. I promised we would do this. Flip with me to Ephesians chapter 4. And we spent all of our time on Ephesians 4 last week, so we won't spend a ton of time here, but I want you to see this, that spiritual growth happens in church relationships. We don't find a description in Scripture about another way that spiritual growth happens like this. It happens in the church. Everybody in verse 11, I can't see. And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastor teachers for the equipping of the saints. These guys equip the saints to do the work of the ministry, and the work of the ministry is edifying or building up, upbuilding the body of Christ. That's the point. It's happened slowly over a long period of time that the saints are doing the work because they're the ones that have a variety of spiritual gifts, and they're building up the body of Christ. They're building up the church to this goal, verse 13, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man. Do you hear that? The growth goal, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Does that sound a little bit like what Jesus meant when he said, go and make disciples of all the world, of all the nations? What is a disciple? A person who looks like Jesus. And where are those people made? In the congregation. Which is why the apostles left. Jesus gave them the Great Commission, and they left. And the rest of the New Testament is about starting churches, because that is the disciple-making machine. So that, in verse 14, that we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, we grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, and from whom the whole body, remember these strings, everybody, the whole body is joined and knit together by what every joint supplies. Every single person in this room is supplying something according to the effective working by which, here we go, every part does its share. And that is when growth happens in the body for the edifying of itself in love. Does that sound like that's a type of mechanism that only God would have thought of to do? Build us together in a way that we depend upon one another. So here's the first thing. Other church members need you for their spiritual growth. And let me just put it this way. One of the reasons that church is so special is because at church, you've got somebody in your corner. You guys have seen plenty of boxing movies, right? Where you need someone in that corner who is ready with the water, is ready to repair your skin that's been busted open from your eye, and is there because they're watching the fight from without, which gives them pretty interesting what? Perspective on what you need to do or what you need to stop doing, right? And that's why we have one another. How many people do you need in your corner? You need one person in your corner? How about 100 people in your corner? Do you want 100 people in your corner? Then go to church, right? And that's what we do for one another. And Ephesians 4 tells us spiritual growth happens in the congregation. It happens in the spiritual relationships. So other church members need you for their spiritual growth. And here's the next one. This is the harder one. You need other church members for your spiritual growth. Somebody said, No, I don't. This passage is for you. Verse 20. But now indeed there are many members. There are many members, but there's one body. And the eye cannot say to the hand, what do I need a hand for? I'm the eye. You all want to be me. Right, the eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. Nor again the head to the feet, I don't need you. No, much rather, and now he takes us to a whole different illustration. No, much rather, those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, on those we bestow greater honor. And our unpresentable parts have greater modesty, but our presentable parts have no need. But God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no schism, no separation in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. Let's say that together. Should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. Or if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. And as he wrote this, I just picture the Apostle Paul thinking that person that's sitting in the congregation saying, yeah, that's all nice, but I don't need these people. I got my devotional book. I've got my Christian music. I've got my prayer closet. I don't need these people. What do I need these people for? A lot of them are a lot more messed up than I am. It takes faith to believe what God is saying here, that you don't have all the spiritual gifts. And there may be someone in the congregation who you have no respect for whatsoever, but they have a spiritual gift that you do not have, and you need it, or you'll never grow in that particular area. You'll never be built up in that area. And then you have to admit, oh, God, you're right. I thought I was so much better than that person. I mean, my life is so much more clean and tidy than theirs. But they just taught me something that I would never have learned on my own. And now I'm growing. Do I need other people for my spiritual growth? Here in 1 Corinthians 12, Romans 12, in many places in Scripture, we could go and say, absolutely I do. Absolutely I do. In fact, if they do not show up, if they do not do their job, I won't grow. I'm dependent upon them. So, what we see here, just these set of verses, is that God built church members to need other church members for spiritual growth. And other church members need you for their spiritual growth, and you need other church members for your spiritual growth. Let me put it this way. One of the things that makes church so special is that it's a team. Now, some of you didn't play team sports. you played golf or tennis, or maybe you did boxing, and some of you played team sports. Some of you were even on the church softball team. Anybody remember those days? Now, this is the camp church. What was it like? What kind of noise was being made in the dugout when a camp member was up to bat? Do you guys remember that at all? We were all quiet with our heads bowed in prayer. You remember that? And our coach said, "Hey, everybody, come on. Let's be quiet. Everybody, keep it calm." You guys remember that? Was that what it was like? I remember a group of people acting like apes, right? Losing their minds when somebody just got to first base, right? That's their first ball they've hit out of the infield. And then they come out with these insane songs that don't make any sense. And you're out in the outfield and you need every insane song you can hear. You're at base. You need every crazy cheer. Right? Help me out with some. What were some of those? We had some good ones. Good. Hey, say it for us. Say it for us the way you said it. And you would hear how we say that. You're like, okay, I know what he means. I know what he means. I should hit the ball with the bat. What was that one? Oh, man. And it was so much fun to have a team, wasn't it? But so many of us do the spiritual life totally by ourselves. And we get so discouraged. And we can't overcome certain sin habits. And the only reason we can't, I mean, we've been stuck in it for years, but the only reason we can't overcome it is because we're trying to do it by ourselves. And we find out through experience, in one moment at church, I confessed this to a small group of trusted Christians, and it was broken like that. How many of you have seen that? Because the church locked together that way through loving, spirit-filled relationships is unstoppable. Those are the promises of Scripture. You've got 100 people in your corner. You've got 100 people on your team all screaming like they've lost their minds for you to run your race. And then even people who've gone on before you, according to the book of Hebrews, a great cloud of witnesses, they're screaming for you to run your race. Isn't it great to be part of a team? And that's what church is. And so somebody comes to you and says, "Well, can't I be a Christian without going to church?" And you're looking at them like, "Man, you just don't get it. How can you just not get it? This is basic stuff. This is what God is. God loves his people. And before time, he chose to have a people. And he kept that from Abraham all the way through the Bible. I'm going to have a people. I'm going to have a family. And there are going to be all these people who have tied together by their relationship with Jesus. And I'm going to put my spirit, one spirit, in every single one of them. And there's going to be one faith and one baptism and one Lord and one King of all kings. And they're going to be the family of all families. And I'm going to build them a house. And when they all get here, it is going to be the most awesome thing anybody has ever known. Because they're all on the same team. And they're all for each other." Would you guys say this with me? Say this after me. Say, "I'm for you." Would you say that? "I'm for you." Now, this time, say it like you're on our softball team. Ready? "I'm for you. I'm for you. I'm not showing up on Sunday mornings to put you down or say I'm better than you or why can't you get your act together. I'm here saying I want you. I want the best for you, and I'm on your team because we win, everybody, as a team. It's not just about me crossing the finish line. We're all tied together. We all have to cross the finish line together, right? So let me just end the way I started. Father God wants us to be distinguished by our relationships. Would you say that with me? Father God wants us to be distinguished by our relationships. I was working with a millennial some years ago, which millennials are awesome. She was the best, most typical millennial you've ever met. And on top of that, she was what we would call a hippie. And so church came up in our conversation, and I looked at her and said, "I love church." And her jaw just dropped, and her eyes boggled. She's like, "What are you talking about? Why would anybody love church?" Right? And that's our moment to shine the glory of God to the world to say, let me tell you why. And I'm going to describe to you something that you don't know anything about, but is the best that there is. Let us be distinguished by our relationships to a lost world by telling them and showing them just how dependent we are upon our relationships in the congregation. So let me close with these two things, and I'm going to ask Michelle to come on up, and we're going to have some music in a moment. I'm going to be quiet and step back so that you can do some thinking and some praying, okay, on your own. We're going to make this kind of private in just a moment. This is your time for you to do business alone with the Lord, and I'm going to step out of the way. Two things, and the most important is this. Relationships. How is your relationship with Jesus? What's standing in the way? It just flashed into your mind. The Spirit just showed you what it was. Did you catch that? And when he does that, that's his grace saying, now you have a chance. Do you want to do something about it? What's standing in the way? Let's confess that thing and let's be determined to pull the power of the church in together to break that thing. But here's the second thing. First is, how's your relationship with Jesus? Second is this, how is your relationship with your church family? Is it time to invite somebody over for dinner? Is it time maybe to fix a broken relationship? To confess something to somebody? Is it time just to grab somebody and just pray over them? I always envision using that lobby for that. I just want to, as a pastor, walk through that lobby and see people just praying with one another. And you do it, and you decide to do it, and you just make their day, it just makes your day, right? Is it time to send a card? How are your relationships with your church family? Let's take some time and just pray and think about that, okay? And that's how we'll close things out today.